Welcome to St. Joseph Parish on this, the 18th Sunday in Ordinary Time. Following foolishly after the things of this world leads us in the wrong direction. Temptation is all around us. It is tempting to get ahead at the expense of others, and we are tempted to put material things ahead of spiritual wealth. Let us pray for the grace to follow Christian virtues. For what profit comes to a man from all the toil and anxiety of heart if we are not rich in what matters to God? Our entrance hymn is number 313. Gather Your People, number 313. Please stand.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
My brothers and sisters, let us pause to call to mind our failings so as to prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries.
Lord Jesus, you have shown us the way to the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you've given us the consolation of the truth. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are the Good Shepherd, leading us into everlasting life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest,
and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, heavenly King, O God, Almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. Draw near to your servants, O Lord, and answer their prayers with unceasing kindness, that for those who glory in you as their Creator and guide, you may restore what you have created and keep safe what you have restored. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
A A reading from the book of Ecclesiastes. Vanity of vanities, says Koheleth, vanity of vanities, all things are vanity. Here is one who has labored with wisdom and knowledge and skill, and yet to another who has not labored over it, he must leave property. This is also vanity and a great misfortune. For what profit comes to a man from all the toil and anxiety of heart with which he has labored under the sun? All his days, sorrow and grief is his occupation. Even at night, his mind is not at rest. This also is vanity. The word of the Lord. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Colossians. Brothers and sisters, if you were raised with Christ, seek what is above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Think of what is above, not of what is on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, your life, appears, then you too will appear with him in glory. Put to death, then, the parts of you that are earthly: immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, and the greed that is idolatry. Stop lying to one another, since you have taken off the old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed for knowledge in the image of its creator. Here, there is not Greek and Jew, circumcision and uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, slave, free, but Christ is all and in all. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to the Lord.
Someone in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, tell my brother to share the inheritance with me." He replied to him, "Friend, who appointed me as your judge and arbitrator?" Then he said to the crowd, "Take care to guard against all greed, for though one may be rich, one's life does not consist of possessions." Then he told him a parable. There was a rich man whose land produced a bountiful harvest. He asked himself, "What should I do? For I do not have space to store my harvest." And he said, "This is what I shall do. I shall tear down my barns and build larger ones. There I shall store all my grain and all other goods. And I shall say to myself, 'Now as for you, you have so many good things stored up for many years. Rest, eat, drink, be merry.' But God said to him, 'You fool, this night your life will be demanded of you. And the things you have prepared, to whom will they belong?' Thus will it be for all who store up treasure for themselves, but are not rich in what matters to God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Friends, peace be with you. I know a priest who worked for many years in a parish far away from here. At first, he lived with two other priests in a terrible rectory that doubled as apartments for parish staff and some local college students. The man lived in a college town. The building began its life as a fraternity house before the church eventually bought it and turned it into apartments. It had a terrible old boiler that seemed to manage to keep the top floor super hot while keeping the first floor frigid as a freezer. And it was infested with all kinds of critters, including bats and mice and ants and even an occasional one of those little groundhogs, or not groundhogs, that would be quite a feat. Those little grinnies would somehow sneak into the house. Eventually, he got to know and schmooze with some of the alumni from the college that were also former parishioners of his parish, and he convinced them to purchase some land and build him a condo that would suit his needs. The idea was that since he was closing in on age 70, he would remain living in the rectory after he retired and be the pastor emeritus who would go out and raise funds from alumni for the parish. He reasoned that the new pastor could live where he had lived in that parish-owned apartment until he could raise his own money for his own house. However, very much like the parable for today, my priest friend developed a very fast-moving cancer and died less than a year later, just a few weeks short of his 70th birthday. So I think the moral of the story is don't save for retirement. It's a sin to have a 401k or an IRA, and don't get me started on life insurance or nursing home insurance. Just give any excess money that you have at the end of the month to the church or to me personally, and I'll make sure that it goes to a good cause. Actually, I am just kidding. It's important to plan for retirement. It's important that we set aside money to make sure that we're providing for our needs after we retire, even if the plan may go very differently than we can expect. I don't think that that was the point that Jesus was trying to get across, kind of the sin of savings from the gospel. I do think that there is, however, a very meaningful message that Jesus wants us to reflect upon. Let's look at the gospel through the lens of the first reading from the book of Ecclesiastes, this great book in the Old Testament. The author calls himself Koheleth, a Hebrew name that means the reader, or the one who addresses an assembly. So Koheleth is the one who reads the message that he received from God. It's not his message. He is just the one who is reading this message that he's received from God. The message repeatedly describes actions as leading to vanity and repeatedly uses this word vanity. You might remember from Deacon Robert's homily last weekend that vanity is, in fact, one of the seven deadly sins. But when I think of vanity, I tend to think of a supermodel staring into a mirror saying, "Mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the fairest of them all?" Looking at how attractive she or he is in that mirror. But Koheleth realizes that vanity really is much more than that. And that if we boil it down to just affecting the most beautiful among us, we may be missing where it hits us in the heart. So he begins looking where he may be most vain, perhaps, is in a search for knowledge. But very early he realizes that he cannot possibly take on all knowledge of the world, all knowledge of how everything works, and that it is vanity, and another phrase that he likes to repeat often in the first few chapters of this book, a chase after the wind. I love this idea. Somebody who goes out and tries to capture the wind in a box. It's obviously just as impossible as knowing everything. No one can learn everything or know everything. So he quickly abandons the search for all knowledge. Instead, he turns to pleasure and tries to be the happiest person in the world. And how ultimately is he going to be happiest in his mind? He seeks the pleasure of the acquisition of things. Or to echo what Jesus has his man in the parable say, he seeks someday to sit back and think, now as for you, you have so many good things stored up for yourselves. Rest, eat, drink, and be merry. He buys palaces, vineyards. He buys large gardens, and he even installs pools next to them to be able to water the gardens and the orchards and everything. He buys herds of animals and flocks of animals. And yes, even at the time, he could buy slaves. He could buy people. He had every kind of treasure that anybody could want, but he realizes at this point that as long as there's one person that's got more than he does, he just has to keep working for it. And so he is miserable. And he sees again that it's vanity and a search or a chase after the wind. After all, even the richest person in the world will someday die and get sick. And the pleasure that they take in all of their stuff, if they can even find pleasure in it, will eventually be taken away from them. And if they base their pleasure off of the fact that their name will be remembered because of the farm that they own will be named after them, or the palace that they built will be always remembered about them, you quickly realize that the names and stories of ancestors are only important to the people that actually remember them, and that eventually that memory even fades away. Qoheleth lands then on a quandary of vanity and chasing after the wind. And he ends in the same place that Jesus ends in the gospel today, asking himself, how do we build up for ourselves not treasure on earth, but treasure in heaven? According to Qoheleth, we stop making it all about ourselves and our success and our way of doing things and focus entirely on God and God's will and seeing everything as a gift that is given to us by a very generous God, which then changes the way that we use the gifts that God has given to us, especially, but not entirely, when we have more than we need. It becomes our responsibility to first ask what God would want us to do with it before we ask what's going to benefit entirely ourselves. Does God want us to allow concerns about inheritance, for instance, to rip a family apart? I think not. Does God want us to store up more money than would be necessary for a comfortable life in such a way as to impress others with all of the stuff we have? Again, I think not. The next pastor after my friend passed initially moved into my friend's house, but quickly decided he couldn't live there. He couldn't invite his associate pastor or any of the seminarians that may be assigned to him in the summer to live with him in that house. So he sold it and bought a larger, older one closer to church that could accommodate multiple people living together. I think he wanted to build up treasure in heaven. He could see that spending time with God and with people was the most important treasure of all. So how can we avoid the traps of vanity in order to build up for ourselves treasure in heaven?
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried and rose again in the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen.
Striving to lead lives that bear witness to God's kingdom, let us offer our prayers and petitions to the Father.
For all pastoral leaders, may the Lord open their hearts and give them strength as they face the challenges before the church. Let us pray to the Lord. That our nation seek not to store up treasures, but to grow rich in what matters to God. Let us pray to the Lord. For married couples, that they might give witness to the truth and beauty of God's design for married love, and in doing so, be an instrument for the conversion of others, especially for Isaac Sturm and Haley Lampe, who were married yesterday. Let us pray to the Lord. For a removal of those obstacles in our lives that keeps us from embracing fully the life of Christ in our hearts, let us pray to the Lord. For the imprisoned in our community, may God grant this to be a time of to resolve and conversion. Let us pray to the Lord. For all the people of our parishes and the faithful departed, especially Clara Zimmer and the deceased members of the Jerry and Dee Ernst family, may they, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Let us pray to the Lord. For special intentions that we carry in the silence of our hearts, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Gracious Father, through your Son, we are called to a new way of living. Help us to embrace this daily challenge through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our song for the preparation of the gifts is number 395. These alone are enough. Number 395.
Take the veil.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Graciously sanctify these gifts, O Lord, we pray, and accepting the oblation of this spiritual sacrifice, make of us an eternal offering to you through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Father of mercies and faithful God. For you have given us Jesus Christ, your Son, as our Lord and Redeemer. He always showed compassion for children and for the poor, for the sick and for sinners, and he became a neighbor to the oppressed and the afflicted. By word and deed, he announced to the world that you are our Father and that you care for all your sons and daughters. And so with all the angels and saints, we exalt and bless your name and sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. And to be glorified, O God, who love the human race and who always walk with us on the journey of life. Blessed indeed is your Son present in our midst when we are gathered by his love, and when, as once for the disciples, so now for us, he opens the scriptures and breaks the bread. Therefore, Father most merciful, we ask that you send forth your Holy Spirit to sanctify these gifts of bread and wine, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, on the night of the Last Supper, he took bread and said the blessing, broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, gave you thanks, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
Therefore, Holy Father, as we celebrate the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Savior, whom you led through his passion and death on the cross to the glory of the resurrection, and whom you have seated at your right hand, we proclaim the work of your love until he comes again, and we offer you the bread of life and the chalice of blessing. Look with favor on the oblation of your church, in which we show forth the paschal sacrifice of Christ that has been handed on to us, and grant that by the power of the Spirit of your love, we may be counted now and until the day of eternity among the members of your Son, in whose body and blood we have communion. Bring your church, O Lord, to perfect faith and charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Michael, our Bishop, with all bishops, priests, and deacons, and the entire people you have made your own. Open our eyes to the needs of our brothers and sisters. Inspire in us words and actions to comfort those who labor and are burdened. Make us serve them truly after the example of Christ and at his command. And may your church stand as a living witness to truth and freedom, to peace and justice, that all people may be raised up to a new hope. Remember our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the peace of your Christ, and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. Admit them to rejoice in the light of your face and in the resurrection. Give them the fullness of life. Grant also to us, when our earthly pilgrimage is done, that we may come to an eternal dwelling place and live with you forever, there in communion with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the apostles and martyrs, with Saint Joseph, her spouse, and with all the saints. We shall praise and exalt you through Jesus Christ, your Son. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will. Who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Our song for communion is number 665, Loving and Forgiving, number 665.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Accompany with constant protection, O Lord, those you renew with these heavenly gifts, and in your never-failing care for them, make them worthy of eternal redemption through Christ our Lord. Amen. We had an incident at the cemetery this week. We asked the guys to clean up the cemetery and go around, and we didn't clarify as clear as we should have what we meant by that, and they started taking decorations off of headstones. By the time we found out, they'd done a good number. So it comes down to me as the pastor. I should have been clearer what our expectations were. It's not anybody else's fault but mine, and I really want to apologize for anybody who lost property or anything. It is a mistake that they've learned from. They will not do it again, and I just apologize to anybody who was affected by it. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Our closing hymn is number 617. We are called, number 617.